I'll move to the question and answer session. I'd first like to introduce Dr. Chan Chagwi from the Department of Cultural and Religious Studies. Sam is going to help me in terms of answering the questions. I'd remind you that please spend no more than 2 minutes asking your questions. That even applies to me reading out, so I have to do it quite quickly. And I would also suggest that please be free to speak in the language that you feel most comfortable with, whether it be Cantonese, Mandarin, or English. That's the reason why both me and Sam are doing the questions together. We're not vetting questions, this is totally random. So please bear with us while we take the questions. We'll start with a written question. This one's in Chinese.
今次講座要勸持不同意見人士分享感受到被迫接受性傾向、性別認同及雙性人身份歧視等法。 请问在台湾设立法例，在工作上保障同志时，有没有宗教或中国传统团体大力抗议或反对？如有，台湾如何处理？
We have a question to Mr. Chan.
I'll reply immediately or later. Okay, no problem. Uh, 当初立法的时候确实没有这么多讨论，因为原来的法律我们只处理 gender， 所以那是处理male and female。但是后来法律修正之后，变成是我们是禁止性别歧视，那这性别就涵盖性倾向。最后近去年增加了性别认同。那确实，这几年来反对的声浪是有，但是他们并不是完全站在宗教的立场，而是站在家庭的立场，或者是站在父母的立场，认为说他们的小孩不愿意在学校里面 接受性别教育，或者是同志教育，因为他们担心他们小孩变成同性恋者，因为老师的教导。那最重要的是去年11月，他们有一个很大的反对的游行，针对于进行所谓的同志教育，以及我们当时我们已经法律已经确实要修改民法，让同性恋者可以结婚，所以。 但无论如何，法律并不如同我刚才报告，我们的法律并没有这 exception 是有关于基于宗教的一个立场。但是如同你说的，确实有传统的中国文化。那什么是传统历史文化呢？这其实当然也很吊诡。那无论如何，法律刚才我已经说了，法院的立场是很重要。那目前我们并没有案子去处理到底什么样的历史传统，或者是特别的宗教。 特别的宗教教育目的可以进行这样的一个这个法律的一个排外的适用，那可能还要看更多例子才能够决定。谢谢。
Thank you very much. I'd just like to say in terms of spoken questions, we will also record the question in terms of for the purpose of the project. So even though it's a spoken question, it will be taken into account for the purposes of the study. So I'd like to take a round of three questions. The first question coming from X16. X is over on this side of the wall. X16. Is anyone there? X16? so no one's there. So we go to Z17. Please, can you give your question? And we'll take a round of three questions, and then we'll ask all the panelists for that.
Wait. 多謝大會提供咗咁多實際嘅例子，即係喺外國嘅呢啲嘅法例對於傳統嘅社會價值嘅衝擊影響嘅，我諗大家都睇得好清楚。我先有個例子講咗喺荷蘭嗰個老師，咁佢喺即係作為一個老師，我諗荷蘭同埋香港唔同啊，喺香港係尊重傳統嘅家庭即係婚姻價值。 老師係視為一個榜樣嚟嘅，尊師重道係我哋好重要嘅傳統價值嚟嘅。咁荷蘭嗰個例子正正，我諗係我哋香港要擔心嘅，即係個例子啦。即係個老師佢，即係當日講老師喺學校咧，就唔會咁高調講話係咩性傾向嘅。你教書咪就係教書啦，咪培養下一代。你咁高調講你嘅性傾向係？ 做乜嘢咧？咁當佢即係佢本身喺個性傾同性嘅同志嘅性傾向裏面，咁個學校都accept嘅。咁但係咧，當佢要去到佢結咗婚、帶嚟嘅一個嘅影響嘅時候，咁就需要佢離開，即係因為呢個係對學生嘅一個影響。咁其實作為同志應該尊重學校先啱。 反而係要去即係高學校，呢個就係我哋擔心嘅地方。即係點解同志要咁高調去強調你性傾向咧？作為一個人，性傾向只係一個小部分，仲有好多方面。作為一個老師，有好多嘅教育嘅責任。點解要性傾向要係咁大咧？我諗在座我哋都要去認真考慮，究竟點解咁要去強調你性傾向咧？
Okay, thank you very much for your question, and we will now have another question. Excuse me, sorry, you've had a 2-minute question. Excuse me, you've had 2 minutes for your question, and it's within the rules that every individual has 2 minutes. But you've had 2 minutes.
我明啊，不過唔好意思，我哋大概可能問三個問題，跟住一齊回答嘅，所以你稍後再問。 不好意思，我哋冇講清楚，你打完三，好唔該曬。
We have a question for Y124. Y124. The lady there. Thank you.
第一條問題，我想問大會咧，請咗邊啲嘅港員係佢拒絕咗出席或者安排唔到出席嘅咧？因為今日嘅港員咧，全部都係推動立法嘅，即係支持立法嘅。 第二個就想問下咧，已經簽訂咗公民權利同埋政治權利國嘅國家啦，仲有邊一啲係仲有幾多係未曾有就呢個性傾向歧視立法嘅咧？個百分比係幾多咧？喺亞洲有幾多國家係未有嘅咧？第三個問題就係，喺英國立法之後咧，剛才聽到講者講咧，係仍然有歧視嘅情況啦。 只不過咧係一日裡面有俾人打啦，只不過咧去咗去嗰個只不過喺報道嘅時候咧喺 front page， 咁亦都要需要好多嘅資源，好多嘅成立好多嘅叫做 pink office 啊 police force， 我好多其他嘅資源咧去配合，咁到底其實係唔係呢個立法就係一個最好嘅辦法咧？仲有冇其他嘅辦法係應該係更加適合嘅咧？香港點解一定要係用立法呢個途徑咧？ 第三咧就係香港其實有好多種嘅歧視嘅情況出現嘅。如果你睇電視咧，你就發覺咧，女人啊，如果肥咧就叫豬扒，又有剩女，又有咩沒女，點解我哋唔去處理嗰啲咁樣嘅歧視問題咧？香港有幾多嘅同性戀嘅朋友係受歧視嘅咧？剛才講完啦，俾咗啲好多嘅數字俾我哋嘅。 到底有冇啲類似嘅數字喺香港係我哋可以睇到嘅咧？唔係單係話嚴重啦，需要處理啦。咁到底幾嚴重咧？對比起其他嘅嗰啲歧視嘅情況，佢嘅嚴重嘅程度係咪特別高咧？係咪越嚟越嚴重咧？ 同埋有立法之後呢啲嘅國家，你覺得你哋同嗰啲誒有唔同睇法嘅人係咪有個關係有冇改善到咧？係咪更加和諧咧
？Thank you. Thank you very much for your question. We will take a final question before we let speakers have the opportunity to answer. So can we go to X20, please? X20. Question, please. Thank you.
咁我就想問下咧，咁有啲人咧就會話立咗歧視法之後咧，就會有好多人濫用啦。係啦，咁就喺香港嚟講咧，咁其實同志咧係一個好嚴重嘅歧視嘅。咁就算你出咗櫃啦，咁你都可能會好多意想唔到嘅騷擾啦，又可能係職場裏邊有可能有啲人係抱住一個可能唔中意同志嘅，咁可能會話佢死基佬啊，會係話佢基嘅喎，你小心佢抽你水啊咁樣，或者可能會問啲可能。關於性行相方面嘅，可能會話你點同性sex 噶，或者咧係咪要晚晚都 sex 噶咁樣？咁就或者可能會有啲女同事就話你咁靚仔，咁點解你會冇女朋友㗎？咁可能佢唔想答嘅，但個女同事就會喺度不停追問佢，係啦，搞到佢可能唔開心啊，或者可能有啲尷尬嘅情況，係啦。咁就但係都有人講咧，就係話如果立咗法之後，就會好多人喺度濫用嘅。咁只要可能喺同志即係立咗法，咁有啲人就話可能只要同志喺公司裏面出櫃，咁佢就可能有一個有一個免洗金牌，就話你抄我，咁我告你咁。咁我就想問在座嘉賓有冇喺各國有冇呢啲經驗咧？
Thank you very much for your question. I'll allow the panelists to give their responses.
的確係香港非常好啊！大家都可以自由表達呢個意見啦。我亦都希望咧，有啲對男法係有戒心嘅人士咧，可以好清晰咁樣表達佢嘅意見，因為咧佢表達咗呢啲意見咧喺立法嘅時候咧，我哋係可以處理呢一啲問題嘅。咁要將嗰啲真正嘅顧慮咧，同一啲只不過係有不同嘅意見，係唔想見到呢啲法律出現嘅嗰個關注咧，係分開。咁我簡單答嗰幾個問題。第一咧就關於荷蘭嗰個例子咧，就的確咧，我唔覺得咧，我覺得係要將個性傾向咧成日要講咧，係對好多人嚟講咧都係好尷尬嘅。特別咧係我哋嗰個小眾咧，係非常之唔願意強調佢哋嘅性傾向嘅。但不幸咧，社會咧將佢哋嗰個性傾向咧作為一個攻擊嘅對象。咁剛才講嗰個荷蘭個例咧，唔係話佢要強調佢嘅性傾向，要強調佢嗰個同性嘅婚姻，而係要告嗰個學校，而係因為咧佢係因為呢件事，佢係低調。完全係冇喺學校度講自己嘅婚姻，但係因為學校咧就要去要去解僱佢，佢係為咗係保護自己嘅自己嗰個工作嘅。咁我覺得咧呢一個咧係完全唔同嘅一件事啦。第二咧就係嗰個問題咧就係話係咪立法係唯一或者係最好嘅方法？完全唔係嘅，立法係必要做嘅一步，但係唔係唯一要做嘅一步，係公眾嘅教育同埋大家咧社會改變社會咧先至係最重要嘅。你話好似有很多至於濫用法律係咪有濫用法律嘅情況咧？我覺得如果你問平等機會委員會咧，係咪有啲咁樣嘅情況咧？我哋睇唔到呢啲情況。 況出現，反而係雖然有法律咧，但係用咧嗰個效用咧仍然咧都係未曾係好彰顯。我覺得係其中一個理由咧，就因為法例咧係太過不適當咁樣規限評級委員會佢嗰個工作嘅範圍同埋嗰個資源啦。所以喺佢最新嗰個顧問研究嗰個即係諮詢嗰度咧，亦都有提過係咪應該做多啲推廣嘅工作，令到減低呢啲問題咧？我係非常之支持嘅，多謝。
Yes, I would love to answer the Dutch question, or the question of the gentleman in the purple t-shirt. You said a teacher is a role model, and here in Hong Kong we respect teachers. Well, in the Netherlands it's the same thing. Also there, teachers are role models, and we respect teachers because of their qualifications. And that's why the school said, this person was the best teacher we had. You presume that this teacher was talking about his sexual orientation all the time in school, and that's not the case. That's not what the school argued, and it's not what the teacher argued. But people know that he's gay, because in the Netherlands people can be openly gay. The fact that he was dismissed was because the school said, now that you are married, there is some additional thing to you as being gay. And then he sued the school, not because he's homosexual or whatever, but because he loved his job. And because there were parents in the school who said, this is the best teacher, we must keep him. But the school board said no. So it was a conflict of interests. And in your question, I somehow sense that gay people, homosexual people are less. And of course, that's not the case. I'm an openly gay man. I was a legislator in the country. And I'm certainly not less than heterosexual legislators. I do my work just like everybody else. I'm a normal person and I'd like to be treated as such. Thank you.
Stephen, you'd like to make a comment?
I particularly would like to address that question. As a teacher, my responsibility is why in various areas I have a responsibility to the community at large, to the state, and to ensure that the students who leave my classroom become good citizens. However, I also have a responsibility to every student in the room. Some of those students, a very small number, will grow up to be gay or lesbian. One or two might even be transgender. My responsibility are to ensure that they are able to develop fully and fully participate as equal citizens in society. Therefore, as a teacher, I am a role model. I'm actually a professor in the UK. It's the most senior position you can get in the academic world. It comes, in my case, with 4 degrees and years of work. Most of my students, interestingly, are Muslim. The largest proportion of my students at my university and Bible school will be Muslim students. And I talk about gay, lesbian, and transgender issues with them. It's a really important part of them understanding their place in British society too, that religion and these things are not always at conflict. There are religious exemptions always in some areas to ensure that religious observances that are done within the religious framework can be done in the way that those people with that religion wish to do it. The most important part of things, for example, in introducing the Gender Recognition Act and the Equality Act for the transgender community in the UK, was to understand our responsibilities as citizens, to participate in the conversation, to present not an alternative to British society, but to present our contribution to British society. And that is one of the most important things we can do, is talk as people. We all want to do the same thing. We want to have peaceful lives, raise children in the very best way possible for them, and ensure we have good families and good citizens for the future, and that's inclusive of everybody. There was another question about how many Asian countries are moving this way. Well, there is a gradual move. We've seen a recent decision by the Supreme Court of India that said transgender people must be respected and included and recognised in Indian society. We have countries like Taiwan who have moved, Japan who went a long way 10 years, 11 years ago. All of this move is gradual. It's not just in the European American world, it is worldwide. And the other final one was, do people abuse the change in legislation? Well, I gave a very clear example on my last slide. Since the Equality Act 2010 came into force, not one transgender person has taken a case to court. Instead, we negotiate. We talk about the obligations of employers, of service providers. We make, you know, I have lots of books that we give out to these people when things have happened, and we get them to understand the law and why there is a need for change.
Maybe I could take a brief comment from Ms.
刚才我们第一个问题，老师的一个确实在中国文化里面，老师是一个有特殊的地位。但是我们用中国人话是，老师是做什么？师者，所以传道授业解惑。我们这个大家都朗朗上口。那传道的意思是什么？就是要传授学生做人的道理。那什么是做人的道理呢？做人的道理不就是要诚实吗？不就是要面对你的对你自己的人生负责任吗？那什么是诚实？我们作为一个老师，你当然是希望你的学生完全了解你自己，能够确实的为你自己的人生负责任。那这个也是我们的台湾的立法，我们第一条，我们的平等教育法第一条就说，我们要维护人格尊严。一个人作为一个人，他不管是什么面向，他都应该要有权利能够在社会里面表达他自己。所以你不能说老师不能高调变成同性恋者，然后宣扬你的同性恋者。但是所谓的异性恋者，不就是每天生活都作为一个异性恋者吗？那他不就是你告诉别人说你的婚姻多么的幸福，那不就是也是在某种程度在告诉别人你的真实生活吗？那作为同性恋者，我想应该也有这样的权利。那这个是一个作为一个老师非常重要，你要作为示范，告诉你的学生，你应该要相信你自己，为你自己的人生忠实的负责任。那这是我觉得是一个非常重要的对我们中国人对老师的一个概念。那再来就是，当然那个吴律师也有讲到，这个立法确实不是一个最不是一个唯一的途径。但是我们台湾为什么要制定这个法律？其实所有的国家的法律都一样，它不单纯只是去规范人民之间的一个生活，而且它更重要的是要传达这个社会的一个共同的价值跟信仰或理念，这是具有一个重要的一个象征意义。所以我们法律不是定出来之后告诉最后一个问题说我会滥诉，会好像大家都要打官司，都把都到法院去诉讼。不是，法律是要告诉大家彼此尊重的一个最限度的一个规范。所以这个是我们常常讲法律是什么？法律是一个最基本的道德规范。那还有其他的道德规范，那是更高于法律。但是我们的法律制定出来是要告诉我们所有人民彼此要相互尊重，你不能够因为别人的性别、性倾向或性别认同而有歧视或差别待遇。我想这个是一个很重要的一个象征意义，在任何的民主国家都应该要这样做。谢谢。
Thank you very much. There was also a comment raised and concerns expressed that all the panelists here are actually pro the adoption of legislation on the basis of anti-discrimination towards sexual orientation and gender identity. I would just like to indicate to the audience that actually we did invite speakers who opposed legislation and they declined to participate in the proceedings, and Professor Wong Lai Ching is happy to answer any questions that you might have in relation to that. If she can just say a few brief words now.
Hey, actually, I think 其實最後我們本來想最後才答的，但是都如果現在這樣先答了，就是簡單來說，我們 研討會裏面其實希望特別今次咧係想提供一個唔同嘅法律嘅框架嘅參考。咁而好多關注即係究竟難唔難法嘅問題，其實都係喺一個角度，究竟嗰個立法之後會影響佢哋嘅，即係影響唔同意同性戀或者即係LGBTI 啦，我哋都要用翻一個比較 inclusive 嘅 term 嘅立法之後所引起佢哋所關注一啲問題，無論係教育上面，無論係宗教上面，或者係啲家庭婚姻生活上面。咁其實我哋有另一個嘅論壇咧，下一個論壇其實都會處理呢啲嘅社會嘅關注。咁今次其實真係想睇下喺法律框架上面點樣去關注。咁包括如果有呢啲擔心嘅時候，喺我嘅經驗。用 exemption 用一個即豁免係咪一個處理到同埋處理到啲乜嘢問題咧？咁所以其實咧，我哋喺呢度在座都係希望可以提供呢啲真係經過呢個立法過程嘅朋友嘅一啲嘅意見嘅。咁而喺香港其實我哋仲有一個即係頭先阿吳可兒好開即係好好即係幫我哋介紹咗，其實香港個過程裏面考慮緊啲乜嘢，有啲咩嘅基礎咁樣。咁而我哋嘅過程裏面，我哋去請邀請嗰啲過程裏面，其實都有考慮過一啲喺我哋所認識到或者所睇到佢哋係公開表達過係對立法有啲嘅懷疑，或者覺得即係如果要立法嘅話，要考慮埋啲乜嘢問題，即係特別係宗教豁免嘅問題等等。咁其實我哋有去邀請，咁但係真係好可惜，唔係。我諗未必係意願問題啦，即係時間上面佢哋嚟唔到，或者係有啲即係其他關注、身份上面嘅關注等等嚟唔到。咁但係我哋會喺下次，我希望即係可以特別即係想話聽多啲反對嘅聲音啊，或者即係關注嘅聲音嘅朋友咧，其實我哋仲會有機會再傾。
Thank you very much. Ashley, please add.
如果係純粹組織上嘅問題，我哋一陣間一次過最後再答啦。
Okay. Thank you very much. We'd like to go to a written question now. Okay. So please be respectful. We have a process here by you ask questions either through a number in the box or through a written question sheet. We've taken a round of oral questions and we're now going to move to two written questions. So I'd like to proceed with them. The question is relating to the most vocal opposition voice concerns about how, if Hong Kong enacts an anti-discrimination law on the grounds of sexual orientation and gender identity, they will lose their rights to express the opposition of homosexuality. E.g. homosexuality is a sin, parents can no longer parent their children in a certain way that they don't endorse their sexual orientation. Could our speakers share the experiences, how their respective countries deal with such matters, how such matters are dealt with? And we also have a question in Chinese.
本人是一名跨性別人士括弧男變女，關於在香港接受評估以進行手術的程序，有以下意見。本人過去曾於公立醫療體系接受過為期三年的評估，當時因為長期忍受身心不一致的慘況，加上不斷因為身份證上的男性性別註記，於職場上屢次受到荒謬的歧視，包括被要求以男性裝扮上班、使用男洗手間，甚至被解僱。因此本人當時情緒極不穩定，患上嚴重抑鬱。本人將以上情況向精神科醫生及臨床心理學家匯報，並要求盡快接受性別重置手術，以新身份融入社會。起了兩位醫生聲稱本人情緒不穩定，不符合接受性別重置手術的條件，並言明仍需對本人觀察一段長時間。於是本人毅然遠赴泰國接受手術，本人僅此猛烈抨擊。現時評估程序倒果為因，一個長期備受欺壓的人，要求他具有穩定情緒，豈不強人所難？況且穩定情緒要完成手術後才能擁有，何以會作為接受手術的先決條件？跨性別人士於轉變過程，本已因為身份證問題而受盡欺凌。僅此反映，政府應與轉變中的跨性別人士一張標示其欲重置性別的臨時身份證明文件， 以協助他們順利過渡轉變時期，同時亦不應以情緒穩定作為先決條件。
Thank you very much. If I don't know which of our speakers would like to go first, Stephen.
I'd like to answer the second one first in relation to individual assessment for gender reassignment. There are standards of care that have been created by the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, which is it's an organisation of doctors, lawyers, psychologists, counsellors who all work in the field related to transgender people. The new standards of care don't in fact require emotional stability. They acknowledge the fact that people will be emotionally distressed. What they do ask for is for the person to, I suppose, have a period of time in which they organise their life in preparation for the process of undergoing gender reassignment. Personally, I think that period of time is really important for individuals. What I think has happened in your particular case is unfortunately it's been dragged out too long. And we do know that dragging out that period of time causes a great deal of distress. And the new standards of care say 2 years maximum, 1 year preferably. So I think, you know, the important thing is to work with the community of doctors and psychologists in Hong Kong, persuade them to go to the international conferences, for example, that other doctors hold, and experience to understand the experiences of other doctors in the field and what is successful in this area. In relation to the first question, will you lose your rights to oppose homosexuality, gender reassignment issues? Well, of course not. What you will not be allowed to do, however, is to discriminate against somebody in the workplace or in providing services, such as when they go into a shop. You won't be able to incite hatred against those people, just as, of course, I would agree completely that nobody should not serve somebody in a shop because of their religion, or exclude them from the workplace because of their religion, or incite hatred against them because of their religion. It's simply the same thing, it's comparable. You don't lose basic rights in relation to the bringing up of your children, but your children will also hear different versions of the story. You help educate the children in a variety of frameworks in which they are educated, and all of that brings together to provide a good system. You will be able to maintain your rights. You simply, all that the law does is ensure that other people can also maintain their rights. It isn't oppositional. Side by side.
In addition to what Stephen Whittle said, in the Netherlands, in the Constitution, of course, freedom of expression is enshrined in the Constitution, and that means that if you are opposed to homosexuality, of course you can voice your opinion, but it's like here in this audience, we have certain rules, and so also in legislation we have certain rules. And like what Professor Whittle said, if you are starting to incite hatred, if you would say let's kill all the gays, for instance, then you're offline, then you commit a crime. Or if you say I'm going to insult people because of their sexual orientation, that is a crime. But if you say I don't like it that two people of the same gender love each other, want to commit to one another, want to live together, if you don't like that, of course you can say that. Whether I agree with you, that's a completely different question. There is freedom of expression. The government doesn't come into the house of people and listen in to what parents are telling their children. So if you, as a parent, think it's a good way to raise a child by limiting the perspective of children by saying, for instance, that gay people are less than other people, that is your business. But as soon as this child goes to a school, then the government has a say in how children are being raised or educated. And that's why there are some minimum standards. So also in schools, it's not allowed to incite to hatred or to discriminate. So there are basic rules in society, and I must say, looking at the Netherlands, a country of 17 million people from various backgrounds, ethnic backgrounds, there are not so many problems. So somehow society knows how to handle it if you're a sensible, reasonable person.
I would endorse the previous speakers, but I would just like to add one thing in the Hong Kong situation. Have a look at the proposed legislation. If you think that the drafting leaves a certain vagueness so that you feel that your freedom of expression, of belief, that homosexuality is a sin, would be affected, then you should voice it. Then, and make sure that the drafting does not leave that kind of room, that you would still be able to keep your religious freedom, your freedom of belief, and your freedom of expression. I'm looking at the other anti-discrimination laws. I do not think that such rights are affected at all. But have a look at it yourself. I also like to briefly address your concern that seems that panel speakers all seem to be in favor of legislation. Never mind. If the panel is one-sided, there are many people in the audience. You know, you can voice your own view. Even if there isn't, but it is not the experience of only these organizers who find it difficult to find people, speakers of the opposite view. I have organized and attended many political forums, and very often we cannot find someone who is prepared to speak the opposite view. So don't be surprised, you are here, you can express your own view, and when legislation is introduced, I hope you would express your own view, and we'll have a rational discussion and find a law that we can also all both be very proud of.
I want to add a few examples. 最近的一个例子是在一所国立大学，那有一个教社会学的教授，他在他的课堂上呢，邀请了宗教团体，然后在宣扬同性恋者是罪恶的，同性恋者不应该要存在这社会。那当然引起学校很大的反弹，那也被认为说违反我们刚才说的性别平等教育法。那现在台湾的基本的原则是，当然老师他有学术自由。父母也有他的教养子女的权利，但然后学校也有言论自由，但是学生也有受教育权，学生有权利要能够学习到社会不同的意见。所以我们基本原则是，当一个意见被陈述的时候，老师不可以站在一个偏颇的立场。所以像这个案子，可能老师在课堂上就必须要正反并陈所有的意见，特别针对比如说一些争议性的一个道德的问题，所以不能够单纯只是告诉学生说什么是对的，什么是错的。你要告诉学生是这些异性恋存在我们社会里面，那如何判断是每个学生自己要学习的。那这个是台湾的最近的一个例子，给大家参考。那最后第二个问题是，问到这个性别重置手术跟你的法律上的性别登记的变更，台湾确实也最近有很多例子出现在于说。我们刚才我已经说了，我们现在的要求，我们现在没有一个法律的规范，所以很多问题是行政机关的一个裁量权。那现在行政机关要求的是，你必须要进行所谓的部分的重置手术，就是简单来说，就是不要移除你原生的生殖器官。那这个确实对某些人还是有一些困扰。那所以台湾政府现在已经在研议，是我们要完全放宽这个变更法律上性别登记的一个。手术的程序，变成是你不需要进行这个手术，你只要经过两个精神医师的鉴定。当然，这个又回到刚才那个问题是，当医师要鉴定你的时候，他会要求你是一个情绪稳定的人。那对于一个性别重置者而言，他可能在面临他的生活压力，这个也是有一些困扰，所以可能会需要有其他的一个解决途径。不过，台湾政府是现在慢慢的在往能够符合性别重置者的需求的方向去前进。那我想，这个也是可以提供香港政府在这一方面的一个参考。谢谢。
Okay. I'd like to take another round of oral questions. So if we could go to X27.
One moment. 係，我係一個同志啦，我想表達一下，其實喺校園裏面同埋職場範圍嘅性傾向嘅歧視係非常之嚴重嘅。我自己有個朋友係一個女同志啦，佢自己喺學校處處都係俾老師、訓導主任去標籤去針對，覺得佢係男仔頭，跟住之後就要命令佢喺小息嘅時候同埋食飯嘅時候隔離同其他同學分開，呢一個情況咧係非常嚴重。再嚴重啲，我都聽過有朋友直頭係因為佢男仔頭嘅性格而被學校開除。我一個班主任，佢都係一個同性戀者，成間學校千幾個同學，佢就係咁同我一個同學傾心事傾偈，正正係因為佢知道我係一個同性戀者。我覺得喺學校呢個空間，其實對於性小眾或者唔同性別氣質嘅人咧，係一個非常之壓迫嘅空間嚟嘅。我個班主任佢成日都面對住啲同學老師嘲笑佢娘娘腔，但係佢已經收到自己嘅性經驗非常之慢，非常之隱密。正正係唔希望因為俾人知道自己嘅性傾向而冇咗自己工作。我反而想問一下，點解喺一個學校嘅空間，作為一個老師、一個同學，佢係一個性小眾，佢嘅性別身份同埋性傾向要收得咁埋，但係一啲異性戀嘅老師、異性戀嘅同學就可以喺學校嘅空間好自由去表達自己，例如同自己老婆去點樣去行街食飯，點樣同啲老師去傾自己嘅異性戀嘅私生活，但係同志就要咁收收埋埋，唔講得出去。所以我認為咧，這個性傾向嘅歧視條例咧好嚴重，
需要。Thank you. Thank you very much for your sharing. We have very limited time left, so I'd briefly like to go to the two other questions. C215. In the center, C215. Okay, I think we missed that opportunity, so we'll go to Y35. Maybe I can just go to one final oral question. Please, your question.
我最主要講兩點，其實咧就我本身我都係一個家長啦，有小朋友啦。其實咧就我睇法就話，真係萬一要立法咧，我俾翻少少回應就話，學校要豁免嘅。因為即使你唔豁免咧，而家學校咧本身咧都有唔同嘅取向，你唔需要，因為周恩來佢講到咧，學校嘅公共場所係所有立咗呢個歧視法咧，就會學校要執行。但我想講出一樣嘢咧，爆團咧有佢自己嘅取向，有意願，所以咧歧視法立咗之後咧，就我哋想講任何嘢咧，就會有一個可能性。有以言入罪的可能，咁其實亦都有一個問題咧，就話喺無論係美國啦、澳洲啦、台灣都可以有在家教育，但香港冇啊嘛，即父母唔可以有自己嘅選擇，變咗一定係要入學。入學嘅時候咧，你就要硬性叫佢食曬，唔可以有自己辦學團體有冇自己的意願，老師有冇自己的意願，家長有冇自己的意願，咁呢個係一個問題。你唔係多元啊嘛，你而家係要硬食。咁我想提出呢點咧，就話呢個係要考慮嘅。另外咧，我又想講翻一樣嘢咧，喺歧視嘅裏面咧，就話我哋而家唔係要阻止嘅行為，係話可以有唔同嘅聲音。點樣可以做到唔同聲音咧？可以有表達。其實問題嘅嚴重性就話，我而家唔係走去攻擊人啊嘛，我相信係 問題就是因為人權基會裏面咧，佢支持咗女同學社，而女同學社喺性小眾嘅定義咧係好闊嘅。性小眾嘅定義咧就唔係淨係講一個人。而家問題性小眾就話你唔係就係嫖嘅亂倫都係性小眾一種。
Sorry, thank you very much for your comments. We have a strictly policy of 2 minutes. We are almost out of time. I would like to say before I pass over to our speakers to give some final comments, but if you do have questions, you can continue to engage with this project. Please go to the project's website. You can find out ways in which you can continue to express your opinions as the study is ongoing.
我想回應咧，各位家長咧，其實咧係唔需要擔心易入罪嘅，即係除非咧你要去講一啲係去宣揚、去憎恨人啊，或者重傷人呢啲，我相信你唔係講緊呢一啲。但係你講緊學校豁免嘅時候咧，咁咧你就講緊啲點樣樣嘅豁免咧？嗱，譬如好似我哋喺其他嘅歧視條例裏面啦，我哋就話咧，你唔可以因為一個人咧係某一種嘅，譬如話男女啊咁樣樣嘅原因咧，就去令到佢就唔請佢做呢份工啊，或者解僱佢。我哋係講緊呢啲實質嘅嘢。咁你係如果你係話咧喺學校裏面，你係可以因為一個老師佢係有佢係同性戀咧，咁所以解僱佢，呢個學校可以豁免，學校可以解僱咧。咁我覺得呢個咧就係我好難同意，亦都係會違反咗整個立法嘅基礎嘅。但係咧，你如果係擔心係以言入罪呢個問題，同埋你點樣樣去教育你個細路嘅時候咧，我覺得法律係唔會干擾你呢一啲嘢。
Yeah, I think this goes back to the point that we were talking about in terms of this legislation, or at least in Australia, the anti-discrimination legislation isn't about stopping you having a view or discussion about LGBT persons either in a positive or negative sense. But in terms of educational institutions being exempt, what we're talking about is saying you can't prohibit a student from attending this class or this school because of their LGBTI status. So it's not about saying, you must endorse LGBTI people all the time, but it's really saying, well, you've made the point that if there's limited access to different education streams, so isn't that more important, that it's then therefore prohibited that you can't discriminate against a student on their LGBTI status. And again, with teachers, it's not necessarily saying that you have to lecture or make your status known, but it's saying that you can't be prohibited from being employed at those places because of that status. So I think there is a similar point. It's not about just saying it's going to be indoctrinated into everyone that LGBTI is the way, gay is the way or something. Like it's about having access to services and also being able to be employed on an equal footing.
Any final comments?
Yes, I would like to respond to the question about the school as a battleground, especially when you belong to a minority, because of course the majority will be heterosexual, and so there is a heteronormativity, and that requires actually that minorities are protected against abuse. And so for instance, if teachers want to restrict a lesbian pupil by sitting somewhere else apart, for instance, or other pupils, other students are discriminating, then the minority should be protected. So it's very important that the majority realizes it should protect minorities so that a school becomes a learning experience and not an experience of warfare and of difficulties. Unfortunately, also in the Netherlands, where we have good legislation, there is still discrimination also in the school place. And when you look at the suicide rates of young people, LGBT people are overrepresented in the suicide rates, and that's a big problem we still need to address on a daily basis. There was a question from a parent who said, I'm afraid that there is no freedom to organize anymore. And that's of course not true, because also in the Netherlands, parents are allowed to start schools based on their beliefs, on their religious beliefs, and they are free, the schools are free to teach whatever they like, but within certain limits, and one of the limits is set out by the law, and that means that discrimination is not allowed, but one can organize. We have Islamic schools, we have Orthodox Christian schools, we have Jewish schools, but in no school it's allowed to discriminate.
Maybe we could go to Mr. Chang and then I'll let Stephen have the final word. I've been told to remind the speakers that please keep the SI away from the microphone because it's a bit of interference.
我回应一下刚才有一位朋友说要统治现在学校面临的问题，这个是台湾为什么法律要在学校里面禁止学校或者是教职员针对学生或是教职员的性别或性向给予不合理的差别待遇。因为我们必须要理解，任何人在任何的条件之下都有可能因为你的任何的特征被歧视，你可能会因为你的家里面的状况被歧视，你的种族被歧视，你讲的语言都有可能被歧视，所以我们希望是这个学校里面的环境或者是工作职场环境是不会因为任何情况之下被歧视。所以今天我们虽然只是讨论性别、性倾向或性别认同，但是我们也要强调的是其他的情况也是被法律所禁止的，所以不需要担心说好像只是因为这个，然后我们在学校里面好像就不能够有其他意见的表达。台湾确实也，我们台湾是实施国民教育的，所以在国民教育现在已经12年了，所以12年的过程当中，父母不可以拒绝把小孩送到学校去，否则父母是要被处罚，是要被判刑的，是要被关起来的。所以当然你也可以说啊，这样剥夺了父母的教育权，但是没有啊，作为一个家长，你还是可以在家里面告诉你的子女，人类是比如说神创造的，你可以不需要相信达尔文的演化论。或者是还有其他的状况，那变成是说，我想要提醒这位爸爸的是，作为一个父亲，或是作为一个家长，你要如何去教育你的子女成为一个好的人，而不是你要教导你的子女成为下一个你。你应该让提供他所有的条件去成为他自己，而不是成为你自己。这是台湾的经验，所以我也是希望说我们香港或者是我们主办单位能够多看一些香港意见，那这个也是我们召开这个 public forum 的一个目的嘛，所以希望能够我的意见能够传达到你的，能够让你理解，谢谢。
Thank you very much. I'm gonna allow Stephen the floor just for one final comment, and I'm afraid then we have to close the session.
When I was a child, I was extremely unhappy, but I did extremely well at school, became head girl at my public school, was cricket captain, house captain, I was a Queen's Girl Guide. I kept myself very busy. Last year, I went to the school reunion after 40 years with a lot of 58-year-old women who became 17-year-old schoolgirls very quickly. At one point we talked about change, and I said, well, at least I've changed. And a group of them who were talking to me said, no, Stephen, you haven't changed at all. Oh, just a minute, there is one change. Somebody stopped and said, no, there is one change. Nowadays you smile. And that was such amazing thing to have said to me, that they had never known me to smile during my school time. And really amazed by you. You stand up and you support and you befriend the other people in school. We need more people like you who are prepared to stand up and just say, this is me. I've taught thousands of children in my life, not just students at university, but before that in English language teaching. I've been a scout leader for hundreds of children. I have raised 4 children who are all now 2 at university, 2 on their way. I've never known a child come to me and say, you have made me become a lesbian, or you have made me become gay, or you have made me want to have a sex change. I have known a few children, scouts, students, knock on my door very tentatively and say, I'd like to talk to somebody because I think I'm gay, I think I'm lesbian, I think I want gender reassignment. and they need a reassuring voice, a supportive voice who can give them guidance as to where to find support. I don't tell them to do it or to become anything. I point them in the direction of those supporting organisations. So I would, for any child who came and said, I want to change my religion, or I have a chronic illness, or any child who arrived with a disability, in exactly and precisely the same ways. The thing that parents, as parents, we have to realise, my children have all grown up to be heterosexual, and they're very keen about their heterosexuality, and very proud to tell me that they're heterosexual. But one thing that I think that's really important is that as parents, we bring our children into the world, and we make a commitment on the day that they're born. If you stop and you think back to that moment when you saw that brand new baby, and you made a commitment that you would do anything, you would give your life in order for that child to grow up and be happy. Well, as my wife says, as a parent, when they discover their child is gay or lesbian or wants gender reassignment, guess what? You've been called on that. Now's the day you have to stand up and give your life to make sure your child is happy. We don't know what our children are going to grow up to be. We might have aspirations for them. Every now and then they surprise us. I have one who wants to be a police officer. That's very surprising. But I also know many parents who've been surprised by the fact, my own mother, when I said I wanted gender reassignment, said, oh dear, I had hoped you might just become a lesbian. That was 1974 when she said that. I almost died of shock because she used the word lesbian. We can't tell. As parents, we give them the best guidance we can. We make sure they hear as much as possible from outside, and they can grow up as individuals with the full knowledge that the world will support them, whoever they are. And that's our obligation.
A very humbling note to end on, I think. I would like to thank all our panellists today for sharing their experience. I'd like to thank the audience for your questions and for your comments from both sides, whether you agree or disagree. Thank you. It's important that we move forward with dialogue. I have to tell you a housekeeping issue. Please do remember to return your audio before as you leave the building. Thank you once again for your participation, and please continue to be engaged.